Hello, can everyone in the room can hear me? Yes, it is Linka. And let me see, how can I get you guys to the other screen? No, that's not still on my screen yet. laptop. So Hope, can you say something so that we can capture your voice?
Can you hear me?
Yeah, right. Okay. There's a dog cam, right? Okay, Hope, can you still hear us?
Yes, I can still hear you. Can you hear me?
Okay, Hope, can you try something else?
Can I try something else?
Yes, we can hear you perfect now.
Okay.
And actually, we got the screen working as well. So it's all yours.
Okay, thank you very much. My name is Jas. I am Hope Nakabe, and I will be presenting a paper that is titled Development of Artificial Neural Network Approach for Predicting Plant Water Stress in Almonds. These are the authors, and this paper was published this year in the Transactions of ASAB. Okay. Okay, so just a brief introduction. The research was carried out in California at a soils laboratory, and in California there are concerns that there's drought, so a lot of agriculture activities there are trying to do what they call precision agriculture. So basically precision agriculture has to do with applying, especially in irrigation, has to do with applying the right amount of water at the right time and in the right place. And in this particular study, they were looking at almonds as the crop of investigation. So since they're trying to irrigate precisely, they need to be able to monitor the plant water status or monitor the soil water status. So before this study, what was happening is that they would measure the stem water potential, SWP, and then use this to know if the plant is stressed or not stressed, and then determine when to irrigate. But then this method of measuring stem water potential is time consuming, it is tedious, and it requires many trips to the field so you can take that measurement. So the essence of the research is that they were trying to develop alternative ways of knowing the plant water status. So instead of using the stem water potential, so they are trying to maybe see if they could use things like the soil moisture content, the soil water potential, the leaf temperature, and also infer from some of the climatic data sets so that they can be able to make a conclusion on what the plant water status is and then be able to irrigate. So the objective of the study was to develop an alternative indicator of plant water stress, so that if this is developed, then they could eliminate the need to measure the stem water potential in the field. So they majorly focused on using the canopy temperature. So what they did is that their major indicator that they're going to use is the canopy temperature. So they have what they call, they were having a reference dry leaf and then comparing it to a live leaf and then seeing what the difference in canopy temperature is, and then seeing how this is relating to other parameters such as the climate, the water, and then trying to use artificial neural networks to determine this relationship. So the experimental setup, this is just an aerial view of the field that was used in the study. So they divided the fields into two major management zones. So they had a non-stressed treatments and then stressed treatments. And then they had different types of sensors to measure different things. So they had what they call a leaf monitor sensor, which had different sensors embedded in it. So for this is just, it had a pass sensor, a wind speed sensor, an infrared sensor, and then it also had air temperature and relative humidity sensors. And then they also used their method of measuring the same water potential, which was a pressure bomb. And then for soil moisture measurements, they used a soil moisture sensor from Decagon devices. And then to measure the soil water potential, they estimated the soil water potential from the soil moisture values using the Van Genachten equation. So this is just a setup of how it was. So they had a reference dry leaf and then the live leaf, and then they were monitoring these two, taking the measurements from the two and then using it to determine the tea dry leaf. So the data analysis, they created a an artificial neural network in MATLAB, and they trained it using the damply squared method. And then how they divided their data sets was, they had 70% of the data was used for training, and then 15% for validation, and then another 15% as a test data set. And then some of the things that they did was to normalize the data, and then they use an activation function, the TANH activation function. Maybe one thing that we should note is that at the end of the paper, they did provide a source code where one can be able to get the source code for all the MATLAB programming that was done. And then to be able to find the optimum number of hidden neurons, these ones, they use this formula. So they say they try to get the training data set pairs and then the number of input neurons, which vary because they're trying to vary these different inputs, and then minus the output neuron and then times a coefficient alpha. So they call this alpha a scaling factor depending on how noisy the data is. And then since this data set was very noisy, they used an alpha value of 10. Maybe another thing that we should notice that they normalized the data because it had different magnitudes, so they had to normalize it into a certain scale. It took me a while to figure out how to access this source code, so I do not know which exact function that they used to normalize the data in MATLAB. But then if you go to this website, to Bitbucket, and then you open, you create an account, a free account, you can be able to import this source code, and then you'll have a look at it. This is just a screenshot. I finally figured out this out this morning, so I have not really gone through the individual MATLAB codes and to see what exact functions were used to do what. But if you want, you can go ahead and just check it out later on. So more of the data analysis. So in total, the data sets that they collected were 517 points. That was from all the leaf monitors in both the stressed and non-stressed field conditions. But then this 517 narrowed down to 264 data points because they only considered data sets from six leaf monitors, because since during the course of the experiment, there was need to change the leaves that were being monitored. And then when the change in leaves resulted in some noisiness of the data, so they eliminated some of those data sets. And then from the 264, they also tried to filter the data a little bit more, so to eliminate some outlier data. And then as a result, they ended up with only 238 data points when they were using soil moisture content as an input into the artificial neural network, and only 186 data points when they used soil water potential as an input into the neural network. So this is just an illustration of what was happening. So they had they selected different inputs, and then their target, of course, is to get this temperature, dry leaf, live leaf temperature differential, and then they input these different inputs into the neural network, and then you get the output vector. So they try to vary these inputs. So maybe at some point you could put in maybe only stem water potential, and then you select maybe a temporal variable. Maybe you could either select the depth or the growth stage or none of these, and then you could select the soil water variable. So you could either choose if you want to input into the neural network maybe soil water content or soil water potential or none of these, and then you could select the climatic variable, maybe relative humidity, VPD, which is a vapor pressure deficit, and then the air potential or none of these. And then you could also select the light variable, maybe power or none. So they try to vary these selections, try to get different inputs, and then get which was the best that would infer the temperature differential. So in the data analysis, they retain the data sets 5 times in the training data set, and then to select the best network, they selected one that has the least loss function using the MSE method. And then also another thing that they tried to do was to compare the results from the neural network with just a multiple linear regression. So using the fitting function in MATLAB, they're able to just do a regression of these different parameters and see how they compare and see what the output is, and then compare these multiple linear regression values with the results from the artificial neural network. And then also the Shakamoo went on to evaluate the outputs of the test data set. So using a fit evaluation program in MATLAB or function in MATLAB, they were able to match what was observed and compare it with the calculated values, just to try to test the performance of the model. So the results is that they, when using the artificial neural network, they found that the best inputs were when you use the stem water potential, the soil water potential, the vapor pressure deficit, and the PAR. So using these as the input parameters into the neural network, we're able to get different R squared values. Maybe better to look at the graphs. So this is the training data set. So using those input values, we're able to get an R squared value of 0.5. And then for the validation, using the same data set, we're able to get an R squared value of 0.6. And then for the testing data set, the R squared value input greatly, and then we're able to get an R squared value of 0.78. So this is just a performance plot of the neural network. So as you can see, they considered around 7 epochs of like the iterations of putting in the data into the neural network, and then they were able to get the best MSE value of 0.31. So that's what they considered. This point is what they considered as the best, and then they stopped the whole process of running the neural network. And still, this is when you use those inputs that we mentioned, that stem water potential, soil water potential, vapor pressure deficit, and the PAR, in order to get the target temperature difference. So just to look more into some of the results that they have. So because, like I said, one of the things that they were doing is varying these input parameters and seeing how the target output result was. So when they varied the meteorological parameters, they found that the model performed best when the vapor pressure deficit was used, and then it performed worst when none of the climatic parameters were used. So as you can see, these are the climatic parameters. So let's say when you use vapor pressure deficit, you have a greater value of R squared, and then you have a root mean square error, the least value of the RMSE. And then if you use none of these, of the climatic variables, therefore you don't use relative humidity, you don't use vapor pressure deficit, or you don't use the air water potential, then you have really low values of R squared and then really have high values of RMBS. And then considering the Toyota variables, when we are considered putting them into the model, we saw that they saw that when they were considering the soil water potential, the SP value, it had greater values of R squared compared to when they were considering only the theta V values, the soil moisture content values. So as you can see, when they consider, and then also as a result, they consider RMSC values of soil water potential are less than the RMSC values of the soil moisture content. But then one thing we should note is that this soil water potential was not measured explicitly. In other words, they used the soil water content values to be able to calculate the soil moisture soil water potential. Maybe the accuracy of this is quite relative. Maybe if they had intentionally measured the soil water potential using different methods, then maybe we could say that it's a good indicator that the model is performing well. So just as I said, they also try to compare the attrition neural network model with a multilinear regression in MATLAB. So they use the filtering function, and then they still found that the neural network model performed better than mere multilinear regression. So therefore, they were able to make a conclusion that the attrition neural network provided a better fit to predict Almond stress data. So as you can see, these are the values of the R squared values if you use the multilinear regression, and these are the R squared values if you use the attrition neural network. So with different variables or inputs into the either the linear regression or the neural network, as you can see, consistently, the R squared values of the attrition neural network are greater than those for the multilinear regression. So then the final thing that they did was to just evaluate the test data output to see what was the predictive power of this artificial neural network. And then they were able, so this fit eval function is able to bring, it's able to, the way I understood it, more like a statistical, should I say, function. So it's able to bring different statistical outputs, maybe like the NSC coefficient. It's able to bring things like the root mean square error. And then as you can see, the model was, the range it was performing was between acceptable and good. So it means that the attrition neural network was quite a good method to predict these values. And then the final thing that they did was to try to see if this attrition neural network model could be used to probably predict to schedule irrigation, to tell the farmers when they should irrigate. So what they did is that they set values of soil of stem water potential. So they set a lower limit of soil of stem water potential, which is this dotted line. And then using those set values of stem water potential, they tried to model the values of the T diff dry, the temperature difference values, which are these ones above. So they had, in other words, they had like two baselines, a lower limit of the stem water potential, and this lower limit of the stem water potential is able to give the lower limit of that temperature difference. And then they compared these lower limits with what the actual values are observed. So to show the irrigation, you'd need to have, if the values of the stem water potential were greater than the lower limits, then you'd have to irrigate. So in the extreme right end of this graph, at this point, it indicates that probably if these values go above this lower limit, then there is indeed need to irrigate. And then in the case of the temperature difference, if the temperature difference is lower, because we have the T dry, which is the reference, and then the T leaf, which is what the plant is actually experiencing. So if you have the the temperature of the leaves very, very high, then this number is going to be negative. It's going to be lower. So if you have the T dry values less than the lower limit, then it indicates a need for irrigation. If you see at the end, at the end of the season, you see that these two are corresponding. The observed values of the stormwater potential and also the temperature differential. But then earlier on in the season, you see that you have some points whereby the temperature differential is low, yet the stormwater potential is not really indicating that there is need for irrigation. It's not going above the lower limit. So this what they concluded is that probably this artificial neural network model can only be used maybe for end season values, and then it will not be a good indicator of when to irrigate earlier in the season. So some of the observations and conclusions is that this particular model was developed for a limited data set. It is region specific and only for 1 year. So maybe some of the things that they recommend and that I agree with is that they need to maybe try to get data sets for multiple regions, and then also try to increase the data set by increasing the number of years, and then also to try to capture a broader environment conditions other than those in California, and probably more crop varieties of the almonds, just to see how the model will perform. Another improvement that can be made is that they probably need to measure the soil moisture content at multiple depths. So this particular study, they only measure the moisture content at one depth, at around, I think, around 14 centimeters, maybe 16-inch depth. That's the only, they put moisture sensors at only one depth. So that may not really capture the entire root zone and the entire plant's ability to absorb water. So it's not really representative. And then also another thing that they could do is try to measure the soil water potential explicitly. Like I mentioned before, they use the soil water content, the theta V values, to calculate the soil water potential. But then we saw that the soil water potential was really a good predictor and a good input in the neural network, which means it could be a biased outcome. So maybe if they try to measure this soil water potential explicitly and use methods like maybe resistance blocks or maybe pressure plate methods to really measure the actual water potential, then put these actual values into the neural network, could see how that model will fare. And then another thing that they could do is to increase in the number of inputs into the neural network, maybe consider things like solar radiation and maybe rainfall, to see how these other inputs will affect the model. And then also they could maybe compare different artificial neural network algorithms and also different machine learning models. And then also another thing that we should note is that their leaf monitor is quite sophisticated, and it is probably not very suitable for an ordinary almond farmer just to be able to get all those sensors and be able to get all those measurements. So maybe if there's an alternative source to get all these measurements, then that could also be some of the things that they could consider. So once again, the major output or finding of this study was that artificial neural network can be used to model the relationship between the environmental conditions and the plant water stress. So this is what they wanted to find out in the beginning, and indeed at the end they were able to conclude that yes, artificial neural networks can do this, and therefore they do not necessarily have to use methods such as measuring stem water potential to be able to know the plant water stress. Okay, and that is it. Thank you very much for your attention. Questions are welcome.
Okay, well, thank you very much. So I will ask you if there's any questions from the students here. So this is about using mathematical models to model what is complex for the development of water models and so on. So it looks like there's been questions here from Lincoln and Jared and Abia. You guys have any questions for Hope? You don't have to say out loud, or I can come around.
I don't have any questions. Maybe Jared.
Okay, Jared said no questions. And okay, well, that's good. So, well, thank you very much, Hope. This is an interesting study. Would you mind sending me the paper and your presentation, please?
Yes, I will. I will send it.
Okay. All right. So before we dismiss today, I would like to remind everybody. So this week is before the spring break. And the spring break is normally what I see as the almost the middle of the, well, it's a little bit past the middle of the semester. And for the, you know,